It's the NFL's greatest season ever on home video. We've taken the best of the best to bring you NFL football that'll grab your gut and cling to your memory. It's like the greatest to the third power. Three volumes of NFL's greatest ever videos packed in one full-strength gift set. The plays, the players, and the game. This collection, hosted by Steve Zabel, offers the greatest catches, throws, tackles, players, performances, and much more. How much greatness can you handle? Team, nice concept, in life and on the field. The ones you stick by. Here are all the moments you most want to remember from the 94 season. 28 NFL teams, 28 NFL team videos, plus two expansion teams.
Hello. Hi there.
We're all a little nosy. Football's a vocal game. And we don't mean play-by-play commentary. And just what is it that the players are shouting at each other?
Hey, baby! We're gonna be here all day, baby!
Intimidation can be more than physical. Words push their weight around, on and off the field. We've grabbed the choicest sound bites so you can experience football as you've never heard it before. In NFL Turf Talk, the 100 greatest sound bites of the NFL.
This isn't college. You're not at a homecoming.
I understand.
This is NFL, which stands for not for long when you make them calls. I'll be selling groceries.
This is 50 minutes of impact, the pure muscle of the game. Schwarzenegger saving the universe. Hey, you tackle problems every day. It feels good to watch someone else do the impossible for a change. It's NFL's 100 greatest tackles. This is going to be the high point of the season. Nothing comes near it, and you'll want to see it again. Superheroes, superpowered. Coming in February on video, Super Bowl 30. You know when good just doesn't come near it, and great is only halfway there. We're talking the greatest. Be sure to own the greatest season ever on home video from PolyGram Video and NFL Films. Each football season starts with summer camp. And throughout the NFL's 75-year history, training camp has been a place where skills are sharpened by working on fundamentals. One of the basics of the game is tackling. And while many refine and elevate the technique of tackling, some teams, like the Arizona Cardinals, teach a great tackle begins with a state of mind.
Your job is to seek and destroy. You seek out the ball carrier, and all 11 of you want to hit it. And it's 6 inches away right there. But do you close your eyes, or do you blink, or do you hit him? You unleash fury all up against someone else. And when you make those kind of tackles, they'll jump up in those seats up there. That's your job. Because the game is a hitter's game. There are no rules against how hard you hit him. You can hit him as hard as you have the God-given ability to hit. The people who made the rules intended for you to hit him hard.
You gotta be ready, you gotta know you're ready.
Right. So
play with confidence and pause, and no matter what else you do, you hit, hit, hit.
Don't do that. Look at it. Oh, shit.
There have been many changes in the NFL through the years, but tackling techniques haven't changed all that much.
No, I taught tackling the same way I coached high school, college, and pro. You take your feet to the ball carrier and wrap him up. You preach that. It's really an attitude.
Get out of here! What a weapon!
You have to practice tackling. And today, it's very difficult to practice live tackling because you don't want to hurt anybody. So you have to simulate it with a dummy. You have to simulate it with heavy bags.
Well, the big thing is see what you hit.
If you see what you hit, you've got a better chance to hitting it and also not getting injured. And being a certain tackle, a short tackle, there is more important than being some great hitter and then misses some guy, gives him a juke.
Pass caught by J.J. Burton and makes a man miss and goes into the end zone. Great catch by J.J. Burton.
The most important thing from my perspective is what you're able to contact a player with. And I've always felt what you do is you contact with the breastbone. In my mind, if you have an understanding of tackling that begins with the contact point on defense, is not the head, not the face, but the chest, what you find is you have far greater margin for error. Very specifically, if my point of contact is my chest, what I bring to that then is the ability to spread my arms out wide and have the ability that if in fact I don't get contact center point, I'm able to reach to the right or to the left with my arms.
You know, people always talk about the head, whether it's in the right place. It's how you use your hands and how you can grab on. Great tacklers use their hands really well.
Not only are hands used to drag a runner down, they are frequently utilized to punch the ball out. Stripping a runner of the football is another form of tackling. And this bold maneuver has its own set of risks and rewards.
I think the Saints are going to bring them all. Oh, deflection and fumble. The Saints pick it up.
The first guy there has got to make the play. You got to make the tackle. If you can strip the ball while you make the tackle by putting your head on the ball or something like that, that's great. But usually the fumble is created by the second, third guy in on the tackle, and the first guy's job is to wrap him up and get him down. The rest of them are to get the ball away.
Your main concern is to make sure you have some type of grip on him and just come across with the right arm and just knock his arm, the ball, or whatever you feel that's vulnerable at that point in time.
There's a lot of emphasis now on takeaways, and players are taught to go in there to try to punch the ball loose or to strip it. When a player goes in strictly for the ball against a great ball carrier, and that great ball carrier then protects the ball, a lot of times the tackler will come up with nothing but air. So from that standpoint, I think you have more missed tackles.
Whether he has the ball after I tackle him or whether or not he's going to hurt afterwards, it doesn't matter just as long as he's on the ground.
You're not out there to hurt people, but it is a game of contact. I know it sounds vicious. I know it sounds violent. But when you hit a guy and you drill it and you pick him up and you slam him down on the turf, that's a great feeling. Because you did your job. If you're going to go to the Hall of Fame, you're going to have to love to hit people. And that's what it's all about.
In selecting the 100 greatest tackles in NFL history, the primary consideration was the significance of the tackle in winning a game. The bigger the game, the greater the weight given the tackle. Tackles on or by Hall of Famers also placed high. Other factors included the dramatic impact and the flair with which the blow was delivered. So, that said, let's dive into the countdown with LeBron's Robert Stonewall Jackson, who went to great lengths to bring down Terdell Middleton in 1980, just one of many ways to bring down a ball carrier. From 1959, the Bears' J.C. Caroline checks in with a shoestring touchdown saver on Hall of Famer Lenny Moore. The 49ers' C.R. Roberts looked dangerous in the open field in 1960. So did Dallas's Tom Frankhauser. The creativity award in our countdown goes to the Bills' Carwell Gardner for this original effort against the Cowboys in 1993. Still, nothing beats a good old-fashioned textbook tackle. Like the hit of the year in 1966, Harold Wells on Leroy Kelly. The hit of the year in 1990 was registered by Denver safety Steve Atwater, who put 260-pound running back Christian Okoye down for the count in a memorable Monday night matchup. Ah, what could be better than a staggering short yardage stuff? How about a staggering short yardage stuff on the goal line, like the one Shane Conlon laid on Harvey Williams in 1994? But another Ram linebacker has been there, done that. In 1977, Carl Eckern smothered the Packers' Eric Torkelson before he ever got off the ground. Sometimes around the goal line, it isn't a single tackle that matters, but a series of tackles, a goal line stand. Like the one the Cincinnati Bengals dropped on the Houston Oilers in 1975, stopping them 4 times from the 1 yard line to preserve a victory. That same season, the Bengals also had the pleasure of slamming the door on cross-state rival Cleveland 6 times from the 2. The Queen City was the land of the stand in 75, but the undisputed king of goal line stands occurred in Philadelphia in 1992, when the Eagles turned back the Cardinals on 7 consecutive goal line plays. Short yardage situations make for exciting tackles. So do long breakaways. Keep your eye on the right side of the screen. That's Cecil Corky Taylor nabbing John Hoffman at the one in 1955. Joe the Jet Perry was as fast as his nickname sounds, but on this play from 1953, it was Warren Lahr who turned on the afterburners. In 1958, Ray Matthews experienced the ultimate frustration of a man in the clear. He was caught from behind. Tracking down a ball carrier from behind requires not just speed, but persistence. The Falcons' Joel Williams gets the Countdown's Best Hustle Award for this effort against Dallas in 1980. Great defensive hustle can't be topped, except by great offensive hustle. In the first series of his first start ever, legendary quarterback Bart Starr threw a pass that was intercepted by the Colts' Big Daddy Lipscomb. In a play that epitomizes the character of the Lombardi Packers, Starr ran down his mistake and made the tackle. Afterwards, Coach Lombardi said to his youthful quarterback, "Starr, I detest the interception, but that was a damn fine tackle."
First and 10, Miami Marino's back. He's going long. Irving Fryer.
But offensive hustle isn't just a thing of the past. In 1994, receiver O.J. McDuffie of the Dolphins got off his duck after an interception to chase down Donnell Wolford of the Bears.
He's up the middle of the 40. He's to the 45, to midfield, to the 45, down to the 40. Ball is punched out of there. And the Dolphins have recovered at the 36-yard line. You can't ask for any crazier happenings.
Oh, yeah? Well, in 1978, Cowboy speedster Tony Dorsett, one of the NFL's brightest stars, was brought down to earth by unheralded Clarence Chapman of the Saints. In 1983, a star caught a star when Eric Dickerson was snagged from behind by the NFL's fastest man, Darryl Green. Two all-time greats going heel-to-toe. A fitting finish to some of the NFL's greatest efforts. It's no accident that most of the great tacklers are in the Hall of Fame or well on their way. Pittsburgh's Greg Lloyd can turn in a textbook tackle with ease. But like the great ones, he is also able to adjust. Against the Chargers in 1993, he anticipated this reverse and changed direction in mid-course to make the play. No amount of anticipation could stop number 74, Merlin Olsen, from beating the pulling guard on this play. Hall of Fame Cowboy Bob Lilly was double-teamed routinely throughout his career, to little avail. Defensive tackle Leo the Lion Nomellini of the 49ers didn't miss a game in 14 years and didn't miss his prey once in sight. Leo's legacy of line play has been continued by the likes of Reggie White. Hey, that's Joe Montana. White has even added a few touches of his own. You've heard of the catch and run? Well, in 1987, he pulled off the tackle and run. 300 pounds never moved so fast. What makes Buffalo's Bruce Smith so special isn't sacking the quarterback, it's the moves he makes to get there. In 1987, Smith beat his man to call a fumble on Colt quarterback Sean Salisbury. His third sack of the day, and first ever touchdown. Richard Dent's repertoire of moves includes several of the high-flying variety. In 1988, he went over the top to snare Joe Montana. Dent's teammate, Mike Singletary, was capable of taking to the air enough, as he did here in 1988. But he was at his best, running over someone to get to the ball carrier. Hall of Famer Ted Hendricks earns his way into the countdown for fending off two blockers to snag the runner in 1974. Nothing could stop the Rams' Deacon Jones, not even holding. Makes his case for the countdown at the expense of fellow Hall of Famer Bart Starr. Modern pro football is a game of specialists with clearly defined roles and responsibilities. Defensive tackles are supposed to bowl over blockers and crunch quarterbacks. What they're not supposed to do is what Randy White did on December 21st of 1980. Chasing down ball carriers is more the specialty of defensive backs like Detroit's Lem Barney. Hall of Famer Dick Nitrain Lane didn't chase him down, he knocked him down. Nitrain's hang 'em high style sprouts for one Billy Kilmer in 1962. The Falcons' Tommy Noble showed innovation by using the blocking back to bring in 1976. Dick Butkus' punishing style of play helped reposition of linebacker. In an ironic twist, he makes our countdown not for a bone-jarring hit, but for this shoestring tackle against the Vikings. Another player who redefined his position was Hall of Fame safety Larry Wilson, the inventor of the safety blitz. Wilson scores high marks for this crafty effort on the Cowboys' Calvin Hill in 1972. Rams and Saints game in 1989 is best remembered as the night Flipper Anderson set the single game record for receiving yards with 336. But the game was also an overtime thriller, and it was a play by linebacker Kevin Green that set the stage for a Ram victory. On third and one in sudden death, Green leapt over a blocker to stuff Dalton Hilliard. The tackle forced a punt, and the Rams kicked a field goal on the ensuing possession to win 20-17. In 1976, the Giants were on the Cowboy 5, trailing 9-3 late in the fourth quarter, when Craig Morton was blasted by Harvey Martin. The Cowboys won the contest and later the NFC East by a single game. An aging Johnny Unitas was inserted into a game against Cleveland in 1971, his Colts trailing 14-13 in the fourth quarter. Unawed, the Browns greeted the legend with a four-man rush and put the game away. In 1987, the perennially downtrodden Saints had a chance to clinch their first ever winning season. All they had to do was keep the Steelers out of the end zone on fourth down in the fourth quarter.
Pitching it to Pollard, sweeping left. He stopped short of the goal line. The Saints have held them. The Saints are winners for the first time in 21 years.
On fourth and one in 1985, the Jets also came away winners as Marty Lyons derailed a Colt runner on the four-yard line to ensure a 25-20 victory. A crucial play on their way to a home wildcard game. The Houston Oilers needed a win in their final game of the 1987 season to qualify for a wildcard. With the Bengals showing signs of rallying in the fourth quarter, the Oilers defense rose to the occasion to preserve a 21-17 victory. In 1979, with the Redskins up by six with less than 2 minutes to play, John Riggins was stopped on a critical third down play by Larry Cole. Dallas scored on its next possession to steal the NFC East crown away from their Redskin rivals on the last day of the season. On the last day of the season in 1981, the Buccaneers' Leroy Selman beat his man to force a fumble on the Lions' Eric Hipple. David Logan returned the loose ball for a touchdown as the Bucs went to the playoffs and the Lions went home. No series has produced as many momentous tackles as the Rams and Vikings. In 1969, Carl Eller sacked Roman Gabriel for his safety in the fourth quarter to ice a playoff game 23-20 in frigid Bloomington, Minnesota. 5 years later in the NFC Championship, quarterback James Harris tried to rally the Rams from a 7-3 deficit with an improvised pass to Harold Jackson in the third quarter. Hustling Jeff Wright pushed Jackson out at the two, a pivotal play, as Hass would eventually throw an interception to kill the drive, and the Vikes would go on to win 14-10. In a 1976 regular season meeting, Jackson was pushed out of bounds by Nate Allen, again, just inches from pay dirt. The Rams squandered a golden opportunity for a touchdown, and the game would end up in a 10-10 tie. 3 months later, the two teams met in the NFC Championship in a near identical situation in the first quarter. Taking no chances, quarterback Pat Hayden called his own number, but was met by a surging fury of purple shirts. The tackle forced the Rams to settle for a field goal. That's where disaster struck. The attempt was blocked by Nate Allen, and Bobby Bryant returned the ball 90 yards for a touchdown, breaking the game open. The Vikings won 24-13 and advanced to Super Bowl 11.
25-20-15 and 10-5, touchdown on a blocked field goal.
Minnesota.
The Rams achieved a small measure of revenge in 1985 when they held a 13-10 lead on the last play of their regular season meeting with the Vikings.
Wing on the right, I formation behind Kramer, turn and a give. Darren Nelson hit at the one. He didn't go in. They stop him at the 1 yard line. And
the Rams would later claim the NFC West title, just one game better than the powerful 49ers. In playoff games, the importance of every tackle is magnified. Leading 10-7 in the fourth quarter of the 1979 wildcard game, Curly Culp and the Houston defense snuffed out a late Denver rally. In 1971, the Redskins' Larry Brown was thrown for a loss on fourth and one at the San Francisco 11, a key stop as the 49ers wound up winning the divisional playoff 24-20. In 1976, the Rams had a slim 14-12 lead over Cowboys as Captain Comeback Roger Staubach tried desperately to work his playoff magic with under 2 minutes to play. On fourth down, he threw to Billy Joe Dupree, who was tackled near the first down marker. But did he make it? The officials measured. The players and fans waited. The football and the game belong to the Rams. In 1968, Baltimore threw a nine-man rush at Minnesota quarterback Joe Capp. Bubba Smith jarred the ball loose, and Mike Curtis plucked the pigskin out of the air. Curtis raced 60 yards for a touchdown, putting the Colts up 21-0, and putting the divisional playoff out of reach for the Vikings. In 1970, with under 5 minutes to play, Dallas held a slim 3-0 lead over Detroit. Dallas sacked Greg Landry for a safety to sew up a 5-0 playoff win. In a 1969 AFL playoff, Bill Mathis was stuffed at the goal line by Willie Lanier and Jim Lynch on second down. Instead of a touchdown, the Jets settled for a field goal to tie. The Chiefs later scored a touchdown and won 13-6. Another missed touchdown opportunity occurred in 1984 when the Rams' Dwayne Crutchfield was thrown for a 3-yard loss by the Giants' Leonard Marshall on second down from the 5-yard line. The Rams kicked a field goal and eventually lost 16-13. In 1970, Gary Quazzo was dropped for a 7-yard loss by Tom Hart. The result? A long missed field goal that proved to be the difference as the Niners triumphed 17-14. Tied 23-all in overtime, Lorenzo White was hammered by Rod Woodson and fumbled. Pittsburgh recovered, and soon after, Gary Anderson kicked a 50-yard field goal to win the AFC wild card for the black and gold in 1989.
And I asked for a big defensive play, and Rod Woodson came through.
In 1977, the Colts held a 3-point lead in the fourth quarter against the Raiders. They turned to a conservative ground game to protect their lead, a ground game the Raider D shut down resoundingly. The door was open for the ghost to the post, a pass that enabled the Raiders to tie the game and eventually win in two overtimes. Another overtime thriller occurred in 1981. Trailed 38-31 with the Dolphins parked on their 12-yard line. Gary Johnson of the Chargers forced a fumble from the Dolphins' Andre Franklin. San Diego recovered.
Hands off to the first man. The ball's on the ground. Chargers have recovered.
Dan Fouts led the Lightning Bolts on a drive that culminated with a touchdown pass to James Brooks to send the game to sudden death where the Chargers plot the win. In an ironic turn 1 week later, it was a Charger fumble by Chuck Muncy in the third quarter that all but sealed the fate of the Chargers as they went down to a cold defeat in the infamous Ice Bowl II AFC Championship in 1981. In 1986, with under 2 minutes to play in Denver leading 20-17, the Patriots tried to start a two-minute drill. Rulon Jones ended the drill early with a safety on Tony Eason, giving the game to the Orange.
trailing with just over a minute left to play in the 1987 AFC Championship. The Cleveland Browns gave the ball to dependable running back Erminer, who appeared he would score.
Miner loses the ball.
He didn't.
Denver recovers the fumble.
At the three, Denver defensive back Jeremiah Castile stripped Miner of the ball, and Broncos recovered to advance to Super Bowl 22.
Castile comes up with it and brings it to the sideline as a trophy.
In the 1990 NFC Championship, the 49ers were clinging to a 13-12 lead with under 3 minutes to play when Roger Craig was pummeled by Eric Howard and lost the football. Lawrence Taylor caught the loose ball, and the Giants kicked a field goal to win it 15-13 in one of the most dramatic turnarounds in NFL history. That fumble may have been the biggest in a conference championship, but the Cowboys' Danny White holds the dubious distinction of having coughed up three tide-turning fumbles in three consecutive NFC championships. In 1980, the Eagles capitalized on White's generosity and never looked back in a 20-7 win. On the final play of the 1981 NFC Championship, with the Cowboys just outside field goal range, White was separated from the ball again. And finally, there was the 1982 NFC Championship in Washington. Just before halftime, White was knocked cold by the Redskins' Dexter Manley and lost the ball. The Redskins recovered, scored, and took the game easily, eventually going on to win Super Bowl 17. A championship game can turn on one pivotal play. Such a scenario occurred in 1959 with the Giants up 9-7 in the third quarter of the 59 NFL Championship. The Giants' Alex Webster was stacked up on fourth and inches at the Colt 28. The chains were brought out. The tale of the tape was that the Colts had held. They went on to win, going away 31-16. The 51 NFL Championship also saw a decided momentum shift on a single play when the Browns' Otto Graham was sacked by Larry Brink at the start of the second half. Andy Robustelli returned the loose ball at the two, and the Rams scored and went on to win 24-17. The Browns had another shot at the NFL title in 1952. Down 14-7, they had four tries from the Detroit five, but failed to score. The big play, this sack for a 12-yard loss. After a blocked punt in Super Bowl 11, the Vikings were perched at the Oakland two with a chance to score the first points of the game. On second down, Brent McClanahan was hit and fumbled. The Raiders recovered and marched 98 yards to score and proved invincible the rest of the way in a 32-14 rout. 7 years later, in Super Bowl 18, the Redskins faced a 4th-and-1 against the Raiders in the fourth quarter, their last chance to make a game of a lopsided contest. John Riggins was brought down short of the marker, and the Raiders had sealed their third Super Bowl win with a gutty team effort. But in a Super Bowl, any one individual can influence the outcome of a game, no matter how unknown. Early in the second quarter of Super Bowl 16, the Bengals were driving. Ken Anderson hit Chris Collinsworth at the San Francisco 8. Eric Wright executed a perfect strip tackle, and the 49ers recovered to stop the Bengal advance. Veteran defensive end George Martin of the Giants became an unlikely hero when he burned his man to sack John Elway for a safety in the second quarter of Super Bowl 21. Before Martin's safety, the Giants trailed 10-7. After it, they rattled off 24 straight points to break the game open. The leading special teams tackler in the Giants' second Super Bowl victory in 1990 was, surprisingly, kicker Matt Barr. On the game's opening kickoff, it appeared that Bills returner Don Smith had a clear and straight lane to the end zone, but Barr made him veer off course and made the tackle. But he saved his big play for the third quarter, when the Giants were protecting a 5-point lead. Again, it appeared Bills returner Al Edwards had an unobstructed path to the end zone, but Barr quickly closed on him and sent him careening to the ground. The Giants went on to win Super Bowl 25 by 1 point, a margin made possible by the hard-nosed play of the smallest giant. Great games are where great tacklers make their mark and flirt with football immortality. Players like Howie Long of the Raiders. Standing up a blocker to make a tackle is standard fare for an all-time great. So is fighting through a double team to get to the quarterback. But in 1985, Long gave his team a division championship by forcing John Elway to fumble in a Week 14 overtime game. The Raiders kicked a field goal to win and finished one game better than Denver in the AFC West standings. Hall of Famer Andy Robustelli was a small defensive end from a small school, drafted into the NFL in the 19th round. But his achievements loom large in New York Giant history. In the final game of the 58 season, he sacked Milt Plum of the Browns, enabling the Giants to escape with a tie and a trip to the playoffs, where his Giants would go up against the best defensive end in the game, Baltimore's Gino Marchetti, in the greatest game ever played. Marchetti was unlike any before him. Blessed with overpowering strength and the speed to pursue, he was the father of modern defensive end play. When it came to competition, he took on the best of his era and came away a winner. Even Forrest Gregg, the man who Vince Lombardi called the greatest player I've ever coached, was a mere mortal in the face of Marchetti. In the 1958 championship, with the Colts trailing by three in the fourth, Marchetti stopped Frank Gifford on a key third down, breaking his ankle in the process. In pain, he watched from the sidelines as the Colts tied the game and later won it in overtime on Alan Ameche's goal line plunge in sudden death.
United gives to Ameche. The Colts are the world champions. Ameche scores!
In the 1960 NFL Championship, Chuck Bednarik, the last of the 60-minute men, saved his best for last, halting the Packers' Jim Taylor on the final play of the game at the 9-yard line to preserve a 17-13 win. The Eagles' last championship. The Vikings' Alan Page was at his best in a playoff game against the St. Louis Cardinals in 1974. With the Vikes sitting on a slim 10-7 lead in the third, Page forced a fumble that Nate Wright returned for a touchdown, the turning point in a 30-14 Viking victory. Over the course of his career, Ronnie Lott established himself as one of the most ferocious hitters in the game. But it was early in Super Bowl XXIII that Lott solidified his reputation. The Bengals' Icky Woods was having his way with the 49er defense, ripping off 27 yards on his first four carries. Then, Lott met him head-on for the fifth. After Lott's hit, Woods never regained the momentum he had in the first quarter, and the 49ers were on their way to a third Super Bowl title. Jack Lambert was likewise as tenacious as they come. He never met a tackle he didn't like. Lambert went all out on every snap, but oddly, holds the distinction of having the only tackle in the countdown not to occur during an actual play. When Roy Girella missed a field goal in Super Bowl X, the Cowboys' Cliff Harris took to some no-holds-barred taunting. Lambert soon took to Harris. The takedown was a definite turning point. As the Steelers regained their swagger and went on to victory. Lawrence Taylor is the one player in this countdown with enough great tackles to have a separate countdown of his own. Take your pick. There's the battering ram. Or the one-handed quarterback toss. Or how about a chase down of the fleet-footed Billy Sims? But by far, LT's most meaningful stop came in Super Bowl 21 during a goal line stand when he ran down the mobile John Elway on a rollout. It has all the ingredients of a classic, a huge moment in a huge game, pitting two great players one-on-one. LT prevailed over Elway, and the Giants surged on to claim their first Super Bowl trophy, thanks in part to a great tackle by one of the NFL's greatest tacklers ever. On a goal line stand, football players don't match wits. They bang heads.
Elway, hands off. Stop! Gary Reasons.
Great play by Gary Reasons. Threw his body right at Humphrey and crumbled him.
Gary Reasons saved the Giants' late season win in Denver, and they soon clinched the NFC East by the margin of that one game. In Super Bowl 16, the 49ers led 20-0 at the half. The Bengals had closed it to 20-7, and later in the third quarter, had the ball third and goal, inches from cutting the Niner lead to just six. Linebacker Danny Bunn stopped running back Charles Alexander, and the Bengals failed to score. The Niners held on to win their first Super Bowl by just 5 points. In Super Bowl 27, the Cowboys led just 14-7 when they faced down the Bills.
To 1 yard line. Giant!
Third down and goal, less than a yard. And the handoff and a bang at the goal line. And he's pushed back. He didn't get it in. Oh, my goodness. And the Cowboys have turned them back.
Makes a huge hit. He makes the play.
Lead blocker Carwell Gardner took out Dixon Edwards, opening a huge hole. But Ken Norton closed it on Kenneth Davis instantly. Dallas held and went on to rout Buffalo 52-17. Great tackles aren't always feats of strength. Washington Redskins cornerback Darryl Green proved that there is power in speed when he caught Cowboy game-breaker Tony Dorsett from behind. Watch Green, number 28, entering from the bottom of the screen. Green ran with the winds of change at his back, signaling the end of the era when offensive players like Dorsett were the fastest men on the field. But in the era of the two-way player, the Cleveland Browns' Bill Willis, number 30, did Green one better, chasing down Giants halfback Gene Roberts.
Into the clear, and with a blocker in front of him, is pulled down from behind by Bill Willis's diving desperation tackle.
Willis preserved the Browns' 8-3 win, and Paul Brown's team advanced to its first championship. On such plays are dynasties begun, like the tackle made by the 49ers rookie cornerback Eric Wright in the game better remembered for the catch.
I think the catch was a big play in the game. I think what I would say, especially being a defensive player, is that it's what happened after that play. I think Eric Wright making the play to save the game, to pull down Drew Pearson, to keep them out of field goal range.
Without Wright's tackle, the catch might have been just another pass completion. But the 49ers won the game, and 2 weeks later, their first Super Bowl.
History could have definitely been different if Eric doesn't make that play.
Sometimes personal history makes a tackle great. And it made Steve Largent the only offensive player to make the list of the NFL's 10 greatest tackles. On opening day 1988, Largent was knocked out of the game on an illegal hit by Denver's Mike Harden, for which Harden was fined by the league.
But real justice would come later that season, when Steve Largent showed that when it comes to tackling, an ounce of vengeance is worth a pound of experience.
The end zone, 2 yards deep, will run it out, takes it up to the 10, 15, out to the 20, he's on his feet. All right, Largent, woo! The ball comes loose, the Seahawks may get it back.
I mean, Largent just unloaded on Mike Hart. Holy smoke, what a play.
Steve will want to put that over his mantle, right, on the fireplace.
That's better than any touchdown catch he's ever made, right there.
In 1966, the Baltimore Colts were all that stood between the Green Bay Packers and the playoffs. Trailing by 4 in the closing moments, Johnny Unitas led the Colts to the 15-yard line. Then came number 87, Willie Davis, and what was called the million-dollar fumble. The Packer dynasty marched on to win Super Bowl I. Like Unitas, Joe Montana seemed to embody his team's success. He had the Niners on the verge of a record third straight Super Bowl, leading the Giants 13-9 with 10 minutes to play. Then defensive end Leonard Marshall pulled his team off the floor for one last shot at Montana. The impact of Marshall's tackle forced Montana out of the game, and the 49ers made only one first down the rest of the way.
They have ended the reign of the San Francisco 49ers.
Hey, Joe, are you still using that greasy kid stuff on your hair?
In 1960, Frank Gifford was the NFL's glamour boy. Late that season, he would run into a man of distinctly different grooming habits.
The clock is running down. It's about a minute and a half to play in a game. Gifford swings out of the backfield, comes down the field, across, down and in. They're dangerous. That's like a Volkswagen going down a one-way street, and a Mack truck is coming the opposite way.
Frank Gifford caught the ball underneath of Bednarik, and he was trying to get to the sideline to stop the clock. Well, he got stopped. I mean, he got hit. Bednarik hit him, and he just leveled Frank. I mean, Frank was level and knocked him cold, of course. And Frank missed a whole year of football the following season. That's how hard he got hit. I thought Bednarik killed him.
His head snapped. He went backwards, and the ball flew in the air. And there it was. Chuck Weber fell on it. I knew the game was over. I had no idea where Frank Gifford was, and then when I saw him recover the ball and I turned around, and then simultaneously I was with a gesture like this, standing over him, and I said these exact words, "This effing game is over." And it would appear by the picture that I'm gloating over him. I wasn't gloating over him. I had no idea that he was there.
And so Chuck Bednarik celebrated the tackle that saved a 17-10 win, the turning point on the Eagles' road to the 1960 World Championship. Today, we celebrate it as the greatest tackle in NFL history.